بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم
نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد The situation at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was such that not many people were able to read and write. Not many people were able to read and write. It was really rare. Actually, if the people that knew how to read and write were just a few individuals, if you were to compare. If you had 100 people, you have 7 or 10 people that knew how to read and write, maybe even less. And being illiterate was very normal at that time. Many of us forget that concept. I'm a traditional scholar of Islamic studies. I have my PhD in the sciences of the Quran, and then I'm also an academic scholar in Islamic studies. And so being an academic scholar, I view history the opposite way than the way the traditionalists view history. The traditionalists view history based on what they know, and the way I view history is I go back into history and I view it, and then I derive my rulings from there. From this perspective, a lot of us, you know, forget to put ourselves during the time of the companions. So the situation was that the companions were majority of the people were illiterate. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam won, you know, certain battles, then those individuals that were captured, if any one of them knew how to read or write, then instead of, you know, putting them into slavery, etc., if any one of them knew how to read or write, then what would happen is the Prophet would appoint them with 10 or 15 companions and would tell them that you have to teach them how to read and write. You get it? It's really, really important to be able to read and write during that time. So a battle of Badr takes place. Or just some battle happens and the Muslims win the battle. And here are the 15 captives. Got it? 15 captives right over here. And now the 15 captives, 3 of them know how to read and write. So the rest of them would be taken into captivity, etc. But then these 3 individuals, you know how to read and write? Well, you'll be taken into captivity as well, but you have a responsibility. Your responsibility is to teach these 10 people how to read and write, and you to teach these 10 people, you to teach these 10 people how to read and write. It was really, really, really rare. And because they weren't able to read and write, eventually they started to learn down the line. Because they weren't, you know, readily available to be reading and writing, what happened is any time a verse of the Quran was revealed, they didn't know how to read and write. So what was the only other way that they were able to keep that verse? Anyone? Huh? To just memorize it, right or wrong. That's the only way to keep it. I mean, if you're able to, because we know how to read and write, what happens? We take it for granted. So none of us memorize the Quran. But and we have the, you know, physical made books that we can pick up the book and read the Quran. What was the reason there were so many people who memorized the Quran at that time? What was the reason? Because they weren't able to read and write, so that they would just memorize whatever they knew. You get it? That's historically accurate fact. You don't believe me, go read it up in the books of history. The Arabs at that time, not only were they good in memory, they used to be able to remember the names of their whole family tree all the way up. This is my father, and his father's father, and my father's father's father, father's father's father, all the way up. So much so that they would even know the names of, they would even know the owners of their pets, or the horses, etc. This is, you know, this is the owner, and this is their father, and they just go all the way up. They were just really good at memorizing, and they just always wanted to remember these things. Memorization, the reason it held such importance, and they were really, really strong. When the scholars came up with, what happened, you see, during the time of Umar bin Abdul Aziz, he was the one who initiated the preservation of hadith, you understand? He's the one who initiated it. Before that, few people used to write it down, etc. But a proper effort wasn't made until the time of Umar bin Abdul Aziz. So during the time of Umar bin Abdul Aziz, when he initiated the project of preserving hadith, and what was the reason for this project? Well, a lot of people started making up hadith. For example, there was a guy, he used to sell vegetables, right? He was a trader. And this is a true story, by the way, I'm making this up. And what happened is, he lived in a city called Akka. The city was called? Akka, not Makka. Makka is different, it's Akka. And people started making up hadith, but this situation, his business started going downhill because people started buying from, you know, like people were not coming and buying from him, and he was the only tradesperson in the city of Akka. So he said, you know what, and he just went out and he made up this hadith. And when he made up this hadith, he started propagating this hadith, and people started, all of a sudden, started buying all of his vegetables. And what was the hadith that he made up? He said, قَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. He said, Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, and it wasn't true, it was a lie. He said, the Prophet said, مَنْ أَكَلَ بَصَلُ أَكَّ بِمَكَّ فَقَدْ دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ. Whoever eats the onions of Akka in Mecca, they're going to enter paradise. So people just are like, oh my God. And then they want to start, you know, buying all of his onions. Anyways, it was a made up hadith. People who hated, if you read, historically, if you read the different schools of thought, within Islamic jurisprudence, there's four, five, or six different schools of thought, right? We have the Hanafi, the Shafi'i, the Maliki, the Hanbali, etc. We all know that, yes. And historically it's proven that the Hanafis didn't really like the Shafi'is, and the Shafi'is didn't really like the Hanafis. It was just there. I mean, I've seen books of fiqh in which they've written there. It says, لَا يَجُوزُ نِكَاحُ الْحَنَفِيِّ بِالشَّافِعِي. It's not permissible for a Hanafi to marry a Shafi'i. And I've seen this within the books. You can find this within the Ottoman or the Turkish books of fiqh, written by, you know, a lot of these, you know, older individuals, or the other way around. And then they would do the whole thing. Well, if the male is Hanafi, then the woman can be Shafi'i, because but not the other way around. You see, if the male is Shafi'i, then cannot marry a Hanafi female. It's just kind of really weird. It was, so you had haters going both ways. Just didn't like each other. Historically, that's what happened. Nowadays, alhamdulillah, it's calmed down, you know. Nowadays, we're just hating on each other. It doesn't matter what we follow. You know, you're Hanafi, I'm Hanafi, but I still don't like you anyways. But anyway, I talked about that in the khutbah last Friday. Remember that, huh? Anyways, I don't even know how I started from here, and then I went off on another tangent. Oh yeah, making up hadith. So this individual, he came up and he made up a hadith. He said, قَالَ النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. He totally made up a hadith. He said, كَانَ فِي أُمَّتِي رَجُلٌ يُقَالُ لَهُ إِدْرِيسٌ. In my ummah, there'll be a person named Idris. وَكَانَ أَضَرُّ عَلَى أُمَّتِي مِنْ إِبْلِيسٌ. And he's going to be more harmful on my ummah than Iblis. Who's Idris? Muhammad bin Shafi'i. Idris, Imam Shafi'i. He was referring to Imam Shafi'i. He said Imam Shafi'i should be worse than the devil. So they were just trying to propagate their own their own, you know, ideas, etc. So there was a need. They're like, oh my God, if people are going to keep on making up hadith, what's going to happen? We're going to have so many things out there and people are not going to know what's true and what's false. So anyways, talking about memory, bring it back. Bringing it back to the topic of memory, when this concept came in front of the scholars, they're like, we need to preserve hadith. How are we going to preserve hadith? So then they came up with five steps. They said, we're going to follow these five steps, okay? Step number one, you are bringing a hadith, right? So for example, you brought a hadith to me, right? And I'm that scholar of hadith. So what am I going to do? I'm going to check the hadith. Step number one, are you a pious person? Well, I don't know if you're pious. It's not the first time I'm seeing you. So I'll ask people around. Well, you know what? Is the guy pious? Yeah, he's really pious. I see he prays Allah. And he does all of his things properly. Okay, cool. Did he commit any major sins? No. I mean, no one knows, right? But not in the open. I mean, openly, apparently, he's a really good Muslim. Very good Muslim, apparently. No major sins. Minor sins? Nah, you know, we don't. I mean, everyone commits minor sins, right or wrong. We're all human beings. We're all angels, right or wrong. We all commit minor sins. So basically, but he doesn't. لا يصرّ على المعصية, doesn't insist on committing minor sins. If we commit a minor sin, then he'll, you know, stay away from it. You know, if you do it again, but oh my God, I feel so bad about it. So from this way, we've established that this person is what we call عادل. The term in Arabic is عادل. عادل means someone who doesn't make major sins and refrains from committing minor sins. Got it? Pious all along, really, really good. First check mark, you're good, you're عادل, excellent. Second one, do you have a good memory? Okay, are you able to have what we call ضبط, ضاد, باء, and طاء. ضبط means, are you able to remember every single thing that you have been told? So for example, this individual over here, you know, this person and you, both of you individuals brought a hadith to me. Now, you know how to read and write. You get it? You know how to read and write. So you're like, and you're giving me a hadith, and I want to make sure it's a true hadith. And I'm like, did you write this hadith down? They're like, I haven't written down. You pull it out of your pocket. There you go. It's written down. When did you write this hadith? Well, I wrote this hadith when my teacher taught it to me, and I wrote it right away. It hasn't changed at all. The writing is there. Not only that, I've memorized this hadith also. So you have everything. You see, you've memorized it and you've written it down. But this individual, he comes up and he says, well, I only memorized the hadith. What did this person say? I don't have it written down because I don't know how to read and write, but I've memorized the hadith, okay? I've memorized the hadith over here. However, Brother Abdullah comes up to me and says that he memorized the hadith. However, he's known to constantly forget. He has a sickness where he keeps on forgetting, right? So automatically we're like, okay, cool, that's good for you. But this person over here, he doesn't know how to read or write, but he's memorized, but he doesn't forget. Whatever he memorizes, he knows. But this person keeps on forgetting. So basically, this way what happened is memory was a very critical point when it came to establishing hadith. So if you do not have a good memory, for example, let's say you did not have a good memory, but you know how to read and write, and you wrote the hadith down, good enough for us. So in order for a hadith to be considered sahih, the second step was what? The second step was, we have to make sure that you have either memorized the hadith, number one, or number two, you've written it down if you're not able to memorize. So a lot of elders, they weren't able to memorize, right? But so then they used to just write it down. So that was the second step. The third step was, okay, all right, buddy, you heard the hadith. Who did you hear it from? Who did you hear it from? Abdullah told it to you. Abdullah, who did you hear it from?
Wasim.
You heard it from Wasim?
Uh-huh.
You heard it from Wasim. And Wasim heard it from Ibn Abbas, and Ibn Abbas heard it from the Prophet. Okay, good. There's a little chain going on here, right? So now, as a scholar of hadith, what I do is I make sure that Abdullah is also adl and dabt. You see that? And then I make sure Wasim is also adl and dabt. I follow these two steps, adl and dabt. And then we make sure from him you go to the companion Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anh. We don't question the companions, right? And then from the companions we go to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So now we've established every person in this chain has two qualities, adl and dabt. Cool? Second step done. Not only that, I've also established that I know you've met him and I know you've met him and I know you've met him. Everyone has met each other, right? If you didn't meet someone, then there's an issue, right? How can you be quoting him when you never met him? So you have to make sure, the third step was to make sure that everyone had met one another. What we call muttasilus sanad. The chain should be intact, should be connected, right? Because I can be like, oh, you know what? I heard my great-grandfather say, I've never seen my great-grandfather. There you go, there's a link missing in the chain. Because technically you heard it from someone, or you probably read it somewhere. Quote your resource, right? Where you hear it from, quote it. And then the fourth step that they would see, is there anything within that hadith that seems problematic? And that only the scholars of hadith are able to tell. For example, the hadith that you're quoting says that na'udhu billah, you don't need to pray salah anymore. We're like, hold on. But you're like, we have a proper chain of narration. We'll be like, oh, something went wrong somewhere. Because that's not wrong. That's called mu'allal. And then the last way a hadith was actually considered sahih was that this hadith should not be in contradiction to a majority hadith. So for example, 10 people say one thing, and one person says another thing. So that what that one person is saying is not a majority, right? What the majority is saying is separate. And both of you have a proper chain of narration. You have a chain of narration, and everyone's adal and dub, and all of these people have chain of narration, they're all adal and dub. But in this case, we'll say, listen, your hadith is sahih and everything, it's all good, but it's contrary to what everyone else is saying, right? We're not going to say your hadith is wrong. We're just going to say that, put it on hold. Maybe the meaning is something else. Maybe its application is somewhere else. So the concept of memorizing was held in very, very high, was held really, really high in the eyes of the companions. Now going back into history, a lot of people, remember last time I came, I talked about the Bani and the Barney. Remember that? Who was here last time? Is it a new crowd every time? All right, who cares? Anyways, people have different accents. People have different accents. I was talking to you in French. I was talking to the brother in French, and I was talking in my Quebec French, and he was talking to me in his Moroccan or Algerian French. So two different French. Anyone here speak French? You speak French from where? From Morocco?
From Algeria.
From Algeria. Now my French is different. Yeah. Parce que je suis le français québécois. Le français québécois, c'est différent. Where are you from?
From Algeria.
Yeah, but not from Quebec.
Okay.
It's different. How do you say bench?
Bench.
Bon.
Bon.
Bon, right? And how we say it? We say bang.
Okay.
Bon, and we say bang. Je suis assis sur le bang. We bon. You get it? It's a different accent. So the Quran was being revealed to the Arabs. The Quran was being revealed to the Arabs. And the Arabs, they spoke in all different accents, right? Yes or no? They're all speaking different accents. So eventually what happened is, in order to create order, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in this, he restricted certain recitations of the Quran. He said, listen, you have to recite it like this, you cannot recite it like this. And eventually later on, people were reciting the Quran in so many different ways. So many different ways. I'm talking different accents. Someone was saying, you know, mu'min, someone was saying mu'min, right? You know, they have people who speak Urdu here. Anyone speak Urdu here? You have the Hyderabadi Urdu, and you have the Punjabi Urdu, and you have, this Urdu and that Urdu, and all different Urdus, right or wrong. Different accents. You think the same thing, but it's a different accent. Same thing with the Arabs. You know, with the Arabic language, some people will say, what would they say? قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ, and someone else would say, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. You know, someone would say, فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, and someone else would say, فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Right? Someone says, مُوسَى, someone says, مُوسَى. A different accent. That's how people in Algeria speak, right? They speak a little bit crooked, that's it. A little bit crooked. I had I had a student who wanted to recite the Quran, and she was from Morocco, and she wanted to learn Quran from me, so I said okay. And she wanted to recite the recitation of Imam Hafs, the way I recited in Salah. So I said, okay, so I started teaching her the recitation of Hafs. But her accent, her inherent accent was so different. It wasn't Hafs-like because everything she was speaking was very crooked. She would say, Alhamdu lillahi rabbil alameen. So then, because I know the different, the varied recitations of the Quran, right? So I devised the plan. And she was married to a Pakistani. So I devised a plan for her. I said, you know what? I'm not going to teach you Hafs. I'm going to teach you Warsh. You read Warsh in Algeria, right? So I'm not going to teach you Hafs. I'm going to teach you Warsh. Because in the recitation of Warsh, that's how you talk, that's how you read. You say, well, you say, Abasa wa tawalla. You see, wa tawalla. Everything is and it suits her, right? No. That's how she was speaking, that's how she was used to it. So then I just told her, read in that specific way. What else? What would you do? You're looking at me all like, what's wrong with you? What would you do? You have one recitation that does and one that does and this person normally uses speaking by saying all the time. You're gonna make them do the What would you do? You teach them the right? That's also right, and it's more easier, it's compatible, right? You're compatible with you go forward with that, right? You only get married to someone who's compatible. Well, it's not going to work out. I'm going to teach her how to read in Hafs. She'll just be confused. But here's the funny part about it. The funny part about it was, this is just hilarious, because she was married to a Pakistani who always said, So then I started teaching her husband to read in Hafs. So within one household, you had the wife reading Abasa wa tawalla an ja'ahu al-a'ma wa ma yudrika la'allahu yazakka, like that.
They have kids?
No kids. They have one daughter now. Beautiful daughter. And then I taught her husband Hafs. Abasa wa tawalla أن جاءه الأعمى وما يدريك لعله يزكى. You see that? And she was reading But here's the problem. The problem goes further, you know? It goes further. They used to, like, read together. And, you know, they say after you're married for a while, you start looking like your spouse also. People say that. So anyways, I mean, he's still Pakistani and she was Arab. So they didn't start looking like each other, but he started speaking with the also. And I'm like, oh my God, now this is really weird. So then I said, okay, you know what? His name was Faraz. I said, Faraz, you know what? I'm gonna teach you Warsh. So I taught him Warsh. So he started reading in the also. The Pakistani reading in the which looked really weird because see Pakistani people reading Abasa wa tawalla an ja'ahu al-a'ma wa ma, like that. You don't see them doing the that's a typical Arab thing. Anyways, he learned to read the Quran and both of them learned to read in the Warsh recitation. You get it? And when both of them learned to read in the Warsh recitation, it was very, very interesting that you have a Moroccan lady who reads in the Warsh and you have her husband who also reads in the Warsh. And it just doesn't, sometimes you're talking to someone via email or text message and they actually hear their voice and they're like, oh my God, your voice doesn't suit your face. That's just typically exactly that situation when he reads Quran. He reads beautiful, beautiful Quran. But it's like, oh, you're Pakistani, you're not supposed to do it that way. No, just don't do it that way. Sometimes when I'm leaving Salah, I end up reading in Warsh, you know, one person was reading behind me and he came up and he goes, you're Pakistani, how can you read in Warsh? I said, because I learned it. But he goes, but you're Pakistani, you just couldn't understand, it was impossible. So these recitations, you know, it's all been preserved through memory, you know, through memory and through different accents. So the Quran was revealed, people were speaking in, you know, all of the different dialects, right? And Islam spread to the non-Muslim area and they started to convert to Islam. And you know they weren't able to pronounce it in the accent of the Arabs, so that's why you know the scholars came up with a science called the science of Tajweed. Anyone heard of the science of Tajweed? Yeah. to join anyone, sisters, raise your hands up, sisters, or you can raise your hand if you want to. Whether the science of tajweed, you've heard of science of tajweed? It's a science that everyone wants to learn, right? The pit science. Well, they came up with a science called the science of tajweed, and the reason tajweed came into existence was to help the non-Arabs, you know, read the Quran in the Arabic accent. To help the non-Arabs read the Quran in the Arabic accent. Anyways, there was always historically individuals who had defined themselves to be scholars of a specific science. So if we look into the science of fiqh, if you wanted to study fiqh from one individual and you were living in Kufa, who would you go to? You'd go to Abu Hanifa, right or wrong? If you're living in Kufa and you're living in that part of Iraq, you would actually go to Imam Abu Hanifa to have this fiqh issue. There was a lot of fiqh scholars, you know, like a lot of different fiqh scholars, but there's always that one individual who like excelled, you know, was like the best. You know what I'm saying? I mean, if you're living in Massachusetts and you want to go learn Quran from someone, every single one of us have our bias, prejudice towards one specific individual who we want to go learn from, correct or incorrect? Right or wrong? If you want to go learn Quran from someone, who are you going to go to learn from? Do you guys learn? Am I in the right city? I'm just kidding. There's a lot of work to do with your Muslim. I'm just kidding. I love this Muslim. This is like my second home. Anyways, where was I?
Where'd you go to for a
moment? No, I'm trying to figure something else. If you have a fiqh question right now, let's say there's a fiqh question bothering you, like I just have to ask this question, who are you going to go ask? Google. Right. How do I make wudu? YouTube. Oh, okay. No, pretend there's no Google. Who are you gonna ask?
You.
Me. Dude, I don't live here. Who? Chef Sohail? Is this Chef Sohail over here? Chef
The Imam of your local mosque?
The Imam of your local mosque, because, yeah, okay, that's fine. Is there any scholars existing in the world right now? There's no scholars. Nowadays, I put a Facebook post just this morning, caught a lot of controversy. I said, there's no scholars in the world anymore. Okay. Anyone heard of Sheikh Salah Asawi? Yeah, great scholar. If I have a fiqh question, I will normally give him a phone call. I'll be like, Sheikh, I have this question. Normally, when it's a question about the preservation of the Quran or sciences of the Quran, a lot of these individuals will refer that question to me. So I will get a phone call, get an email, you know, please answer this question. There's every single individual is normally known for a specific science. See, I get it? Every individual is known for the specific science. You cannot be a scholar of everything. If someone says they're a scholar of everything, you just tell them, no, you're not. If they're like, yes, I have to say, no, you're not. It's a simple, no, you're not. You always specialize in a specific thing, and then you go and you specialize in it, and you become good in it, and you become popular, and you become known about it. The way you become a popular scholar is that other scholars recognize you. And the way Imam Abu Hanifa was popular was because in his gathering, Abdullah bin Mubarak was there. And, you know, there's so many great scholars. Muhammad al-Shaydani was there. Abu Yusuf was there. This great scholar was sitting in his gathering. So when you have, imagine you walk into a city and you have a question, like a fiqh question, and everyone says, you know what, go ask the question to Abu Hanifa, who's sitting, and then you're like, but I want to ask Abdullah bin Mubarak. And they're like, but Abdullah bin Mubarak sits with Abu Hanifa, you might as well just go ask Abu Hanifa, right? He's learning from him also, and they have this big shura. People become known in their science, and then you actually travel to another part of the world, and they're like, I have a fiqh question. You go to Medina, okay? You end up in Medina, and you have a question of fiqh, who are you going to go ask? Malik bin Anas. So you're going to go ask Imam Malik bin Anas, and because Imam Malik is sitting in Masjid al-Nabawi giving a lecture, right? And everyone knows, oh my God, out of all the Imams, Imam who died in the Hijrah, the Imam of Medina is Imam Malik, right? So now within the world you know, but if you're in Medina, you ask Malik, if you're in Kufa, you ask Abu Hanifa. A little bit later on, if you go inside Mecca, around that area, a little bit later on, you realize one thing, that there is one individual there who was also a great scholar. His name was Muhammad bin Idris al-Shafi'i. Imam Shafi'i is there. So now you realize that within different eras, different times, there was always there's always people who are just known for that science. And you would actually refer to them. Someone went to Imam Malik and said, أَيُّ الْقِرَاءَةِ أَحَبُّ إِلَيْكَ. Which qira'ah do you like the best? And he said, قِرَاءَةُ نَافِعَ. He said, the recitation of Nafi'. Why did he say that? You know, there's ten great scholars of recitation. He referred to Nafi'. Someone went to Imam Malik and said, well, which recitation do you want to read like? He said, I want to read like the recitation of Imam Nafi'. Imam Nafi' was an imam, I believe he was from Ethiopia. He used to live in Medina. And he was a scholar of the recitation of the Quran. Imam Malik used to recite to him. Imam Malik used to recite to him, you know, that comes in front of him and teach with a stick, you know, recite. No, that's not what happened next time. But he used to recite to him, yeah? You know that? He used to recite to him. So many of the scholars would go recite to different individuals. So if an individual wanted to learn hadith from someone, like, well, who better to learn hadith from than going to Imam Bukhari or going to Imam Tirmidhi during that time? You know, there are all these individuals living by Afghanistan, Russia, that area. You know, the scholars of hadith kind of, you know, grew up. And as time progressed, as time moved forward, you know what happened was that these individuals. Every time, and there's a hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that every single era there's going to be individuals who are going to be preserving the deen. Every single era, this is hadith in Ibn Majah, that every era there's going to be people who are going to be preserving the deen, because the Islam is a combination of so many sciences. You have the fiqh there, you have the hadith there, you have the Quran there, you have the tafsir there, you have the aqidah there. Mm-hmm. Every era you're going to have certain individuals who are going to be there, and they're going to revive the sciences that are eventually dying down. That's right, from the beginning of time. You know, the science of the Quran has always been preserved, all the way until this time now. The science of hadith has always been preserved. But there have always been individuals who were known as the, as Imam Shatibi says, فَمِنْهُمْ بُدُورٌ سَبَعَةٌ قَدْ تَوَسَّطَتْ سَمَاءَ الْعُلَىٰ وَالْعَدْلِ زُهْرًا وَكُمَّلًا. If you look into the sky, you know, there's a lot of stars there. But imagine you have that one star that has more light. You get that? But you have, you know, there's a lot of stars, you see them, but that one star that sticks out, it's a bigger star. All the stars are there, but you see that one star more. Or it's like the moon, all the light is in the sky, but then you see that moon, you know, it's a lot more bigger, apparently to your sight, and it's there, it's out there, it's like, you see it a lot more. In every era, for every single science, there's always been those individuals. Individuals who were known for that science. The problem now, and this is my understanding of the hadith, where the Prophet ﷺ said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not snatch away knowledge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not snatch away knowledge from a people, no. You know, because one of the signs of the Day of Judgment is what? Knowledge is going to disappear. How is that going to happen? How Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take it away by biqabdil ulama, basically by the ulama or the scholars dying. Now I have a simple question for you. If you have a fiqh question, who do you go to? Being very realistic, who do you go to? The first place anyone goes to is google.com, right or wrong? Yes or no? You don't need to be shy about it. It's true, we all know. If you want to find a hadith, where do you go? Someone asked me a hadith the other day, right? And I said, you know, let me go home and I'll find out for you. But the person said, but I know it's not in Sahih Bukhari. I said, well, you know it's not Sahih Bukhari. I have ijazah in Sahih Bukhari. I memorized the whole thing, top to bottom. And this person, no, I just Googled it, I can find it there. That's the first place where people go. All right, second thing. If you have a question of fiqh, who do you go to? Google.com. There's no ulama anymore. Don't you find this to be a sign of the Day of Judgment? See, back then, you would find a scholar, you actually go to that scholar and say, I have this question of fiqh, and the scholar would decipher the knowledge, etc., and go out of it, and, you know, find a way out for you. Back then, you had the ulama, you had the scholars, you had the Abu Hanifa, you had the Sufyan Thawri, you had the, you know, Malik bin Anas, you had, you know, Ahmad bin Hanbal, you had Yahya bin Ma'in, you had these great scholars, of fiqh. Were there. And then if someone had a question of hadith, then you know, you found Bukhari there, you found Muslim there, you found Tirmidhi there, you knew Ibn Majah was there, you found Nasa'i was there, you know, you had the Muwatta written by Ahmad bin Hanbal, you had the Muwatta written by Imam Muhammad al-Shaybani, you had Imam Shafi'i there, the scholars of Hadith as well, you had these individuals that were specifically scientists of Hadith, yes or no? And no one stepped on each other's feet. That's not what happened. No one stepped on each other's feet. Nowadays, what happened? The scholars, the problem with the scholars now, and it's so corrupted, and I'm really happy that it's being recorded right now. People are going to hate me for this, but you know what? It's corrupted. It's very corrupted. What's actually happening right now in the world is that people are becoming scholars of everything. But are they really scholars of anything? Right? When it comes to Islamic sciences, if I were to ask you a question, name one scholar of fiqh right now, we need to think about it. But back then, if someone said name one scholar of fiqh, the first thing it would be, you'd know, there's that individual, you know right away. If I tell you right now, name one scholar of tafsir right now, can you name it? If you're in the list at that time over there, list one scholar of hadith, yeah. Fakhr al-Razi was there, Zamakhshari, Aqidah issues, but he was there. These individuals were there. Proper scholar of tafsir. If I tell you, is there any scholar of hadith right now? Can you name a scholar of hadith right now? Or are they all hidden? You get what I'm trying to say? So what's happening is, when it comes to knowledge, from the beginning of time, there's always been people known for the science. You knew that these are the scholars of hadith. You know, you can list them up. If I were to tell you, list the scholars of hadith, who are you going to list up? Bukhari, Muslim, Tirmidhi, Ibn Majah, you're going to list them all. But when you come closer to our day, can you list any scholars anymore? Yes or no? How many people have written books of hadith at this point, within the last 100 years? So, am I saying something which is odd? Or am I putting the reality forward in front of you? Alright. As time progressed, when it comes to the recitation of the Qur'an, the recitation of the Qur'an was a little bit more critical. Last time I came, I talked about the preservation of the Qur'an in the written preservation of the Qur'an. But this time...
55.
Okay, I'll end soon. But this time, I want to talk about how the Qur'an was memorized, because we talked about memorization, and how people were known for their preservation of the Qur'an. People were working their regular lives, and they're working their regular jobs. And every single one of us can do this, because you know what? Every single one of us is very good to become that individual who is going to uphold the science of the Sharia. Don't think that you need to go and do this and do that, and it's impossible to do this. We're going to leave it for the scholars. If you're going to leave it for the scholars are going to die. And then you're going to be left with a world that's black, without any knowledge, and you're going to be sitting there on google.com, and eventually the internet's going to crash, and you're not going to even know how to pray Salah anymore. You get it? And one sign of this is what we see in the world right now. Anyways, individuals used to go and devote their time. You know what? I want to be a researcher in the Quran. So if you were in Medina, you found one individual by the name of Nafir. Nafir was there, and he spent his whole time, researching the Qur'an, and reading the Qur'an, and teaching the Qur'an. Someone went to Imam Malik, and I told you this earlier, and said, I want to learn Qur'an, who's the best person to learn from? He goes, go to Nafir. Oh wow, oh my God, I'm going to go read from Imam Nafir. Imam Nafir, people heard about Imam Nafir all the way in Egypt, so they sent one individual, a young, shorter individual who came in, used to wear a white thobe, and he went to Imam Nafir. He was really, really white, and he went to Imam Nafir and started learning the Qur'an with him, and he read the Qur'an to him in 2 months. He read the Qur'an like 2 or 3 times, and Imam Nafir said, you're good, now go teach the people in Egypt. His name was Imam Warsh. He was called Warsh because he's really light-skinned. And then an individual from Persia who was really, really good, but he was deaf. But the miracle of the Qur'an was such that when the Qur'an was recited to him, he was able to hear it. But if someone, but لا يسمع البوق, what does that mean? What does it mean, لا يسمع البوق, Arabs? Huh? If a trumpet were to be blown in front of him, he couldn't hear it. He couldn't hear the trumpet in front of him. وكان إذا قرئ عليه القرآن يسمعه, when the Qur'an was recited, he heard it. It's a miracle. It's a miracle of the Qur'an. Anyways. Academics won't understand this. Regarding Imam Nafir, also a beautiful thing. Imam Shatibi says, "Wa fa'amma al-kareem al-sirri fi al-tayyib nafiru, فَأَمَّا الْكَلِيمُ السِّرِّ فِي الطِّيبِ نَافِعُ. There's one Imam Nafi' who was in Medina. He had a secret. He had a secret. الْكَلِيمُ السِّرِّ. Yeah, and he was a very noble secret, and people didn't know about it. But it was really interesting. Whenever he would read the Quran, I mean, he'd be talking to you, just normal conversation. Hello, how are you? What's going on? Everything good? How's family? How's wife? How's kid? Blah, blah, blah. And that would be totally normal. And then he would start reading the Quran, alhamdulillah. The second he started reading the Quran, the smell of musk would come out of his mouth. And he'd be like, hold on, where did that happen? And he would say, what? And he'd have a normal conversation, non-Quran, no smell of musk. Quran, smell of musk. Someone asked him about it. He goes, I seen the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in my dream. He came and he read the Quran in my lips. And since then, I can't help it. Every time I read Quran, the smell of musk used to come out. Ash-Shatibi to be referring to me, he goes, فَأَمَّا الْكَلِيمُ السِّرِّ فِي الطِّيبِ نَافِعُ فَذَاكَ الَّذِي اخْتَارَ الْمَدِينَةَ مَنْزِلًا. He's the one who chose Medina to live. He wasn't an Arab. He was not an Arab. People say he was from Ethiopia, I believe. Correct me if I'm wrong, but I know he wasn't an Arab. And he was the Imam teaching Quran in Medina. How cool is that? People knew. They're like, you want to read Quran with someone? Go to Nafi'. You travel to Mecca and you find an individual with a beard, and his name was Ibn Kathir, Abdullah Ibn Kathir. Not the guy who wrote the tafsir. The guy who wrote the tafsir came, you know, years later on. His name was Abdullah Ibn Kathir, and he used to read the Quran in Mecca. And if you went to Mecca and you're like, who are you going to read the Quran from? All the people in Mecca, they're like, dude, are you kidding me? You read from Ibn Kathir. You have to read the Quran from Ibn Kathir. He wasn't even an Arab either. So people would go to Ibn Kathir. He was known. He was known to read Quran at that time. And you know, the reciter of the Quran, and people would, you know, go to him all the time. And in his recitation, it was really interesting. In his recitation, every time you, if you're reading the whole Quran beginning to the end, you know, we read the Quran beginning to the end, right? Right? From Baqarah to Nas, we do that, right? Right? We all do that? Do we all read the Quran from beginning to the end? That's the point I'm trying to make. Really? How's the last time you finished the Quran? Ask yourself that question. So anyways, his rule, I mean, and the rule that he got, and he said, this has been the amal of the people of Mecca. The people of Mecca, they always had this practice that whenever they would recite the Quran from beginning to the end, what would they do? When they reached Wadduha, they would say Allahu Akbar before starting the next surah. So they would say Allahu Akbar, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Wadduha wa layli idha saja, finish the surah. Allahu Akbar, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Alam nashrah laka sadrak, finish the surah. Bismillah, and so say Allahu Akbar, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Wadini wa zaytun. They would say Allahu Akbar before every single surah. So one individual was leading Tarawih, I can't remember the name, so I don't have good memory. I'd be a really bad scholar of hadith. So anyways, one individual was leading Tarawih and he was finishing the Quran. And he started reading Allahu Akbar before every surah, right? He started reading Allahu Akbar before every surah. See, it happened to me once. People know me as an authority within the science, within the ulum al-Quran. And within the traditional world, I'm, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put me at that level, and you know, I hope that I can fulfill that responsibility. So, Dr. Ali, this is really funny. This student was leading Tarawih. It's hilarious. And he's reading really nice. Really, really, really nice. And then, all of a sudden, he starts making mistakes. And he's getting stuck and making mistakes, one after another, going on and on and on. He just kept on making mistakes. And like, you know, you realize, right? First four rak'ahs, it was like nothing. And that was the hard part. And then you start reading, تَبَارَكَ الَّذِي جَعَلَ فِي السَّمَاءِ بُرُوجًا وَجَعَلَ فِيهَا. You know, the easy part, the easiest part of the Quran you're reading, and you start making mistakes one after another. So, I went to him after, I'm like, mashallah, your recitation was really good. And he's like shaking, he's like sweating, his underarms are all like wet and stuff like that. Anyway, so, you know, as I say, you're really, really scared. He goes, yeah, you see, I'm scared because you were there and you know the 10 ways to recite. And I got really nervous when I found out that you were praying Salah behind me. And I said, but I've been here for the last 3 days. He goes, oh my God, are you coming tomorrow? I said, no, don't worry, I'm not going to torment you by showing up to lead Tarawih behind you. You get a little bit scared. This individual was leading Tarawih in Mecca. He said Salam, and he was reading Allahu Akbar before every single surah. He was reading Allahu Akbar. Salam, and he kept on reading. And then he finished his salah, and then he turned around and he noticed from the corner of his eye that Imam Shafi'i was there. He noticed that Imam Shafi'i was praying Salah behind him. He freaked out. I mean, you freak out, right? If you know that there's some great personalities praying Salah behind him. I mean, who would, like, if you had to lead Salah, Imam Shafi'i walked in, would you go lead prayer? Not only that, if you were there and Imam Shafi'i walked in, would you go lead prayer, yes or no? For the men, yes or no? Would you allow your husbands or your brothers to lead prayer? Yes or no? They'd be like, no, Shafi'i, go ahead and lead the prayer. Not only that, if you did lead the prayer, this unconscious, you know, or this even this conscious thing on top of your head, like, oh my God, I better be standing straight, I was gonna comment on it, I better not move, I better, you know, yes or no? That's how many of you, yes or no? Is this that thing? And I mean, you're trying not to show off, you're not really showing off, you just have this weird consciousness going in your head. So he turned around and he got freaked out. He's like, oh my God, Imam Shafi'i is there. I hope he's not gonna comment on anything. But Imam Shafi'i, he said, mashallah, he said, ahsant, faqad asabta sunnah. He goes, you did a good job, you actually followed the sunnah. He was referring to him saying, Allahu Akbar before every surah. Right? He's, you know, it's really interesting, but you know, it's really, really beautiful, really beautiful. I mean, I try to do that whenever I lead Tarawih. Now, when I reach the end of the Quran, I say Allahu Akbar. I don't say too loud because a lot of people, they don't know this ruling, right? And a lot of, when people don't know the ruling, what do? They start hating on you. Sheikh, what are you doing? But I'm doing what the sunnah is. No, what's the hadith for it? We're going to google.com. Let's say Google, is this hadith sahih or not? Anyways, move forward. If you actually went to Kufa, there was one individual living in Kufa. His name was Asim. Asim bin Bahdala. He was a scholar in Kufa. He used to teach Quran there. He had two students. One of his students' name was Hafs, and the other student's name was Sharba. Hafs and Sharba. Anyways, it seems that Imam Asim and his relationship with the students was really, really good. Like Imam Nafir, in my opinion, he was really cool. Like, he nicknamed all of his students. Qalun wasn't even his real name. His name was Isa. Warsh wasn't even his real name. His name was Uthman. And so, he used to nickname his students. Really interesting. It seems Imam Asim was really close with his two students, Hafs and Sharba, because he used to teach them Quran and he learned from Zir bin Hubayj, you know, different individuals, and you know, he was authority. If you actually went into Kufa, like, I want to learn how to read Quran, you'd be like, go to Asim, because he's good. And he's the one, the whole world recites to him. And so after Imam Asim passed away, it seems he was really close with his two students, two major students. You know, every teacher has like two, you know, major students. And you know, they become researchers. Anyways, when he passed away, it seems that Imam Hafs and Imam Sharba, they both went in depression. Because Imam Hafs, he got up and he left Kufa, he just took off, he's in depression, you know. He was just so sad. And Imam Sharba, he who happened to be a son, he was, I guess, related to him. He said, I'm not teaching anymore. Because I can't handle it, it's just too, imagine someone so close to you dies, right? You feel like he just said, you know, and he went in seclusion and he didn't even come out of seclusion. So after that, an individual showed up who was a scholar of hadith also. He used to sell oil. He was an oil dealer. Jiffy Loop. No, he used to sell oil. His name was Hamza. His name was Hamza, oil seller. People could come in and buy oil. And he started to start teaching Quran. And he learned Quran from different places and he became really popular. So after Imam Asim, someone came up and they're like, well, who do we learn Quran from? We were in Kufa, we want to learn Quran. They're like, if you came so many years ago, you could have learned from Imam Asim, but we got Imam Hamza here. And he's really, really good also. He was popular, really, really known. And so people started learning with Imam Hamza, and Imam Hamza became really, really known. He's known as Hamza to Zayyad. And you know, just regular person like me and you. But he was a scholar of the Quran. That means every one of us can do it, right or wrong. Just gotta take a little bit of time. Go ahead, you know. Take an hour a day and you can accomplish a lot. Anyways, after he passed away, there was another individual who was a famous scholar of grammar. And the famous scholar of grammar, his name was Kisai. His name was Kisai. His biggest rival was Sibawai living in Basra, because Basra and Kufa, they kind of, they used to have like issues with one another. But anyways, two different cities. Kisai was a great scholar. Kisai was a really individual, a really interesting individual. He used to have this one sheet that he used to keep with him all the time. He even went for Hajj in that one sheet. He said, you know, it's like my blanket. I'm not going to remember a blanket, you know, it's my blanket. Any one of us have that one thing from their childhood they still want to let go of? No? Give it up. I have a blanket. I'm just kidding, I don't. But anyways, he said he had this one sheet he kept with him. He just always had it with us, my sheet. So anyways, there's something cool about him. You go to Basra and you find out another scholar of Arabic grammar. Basra was a very big hub of Arabic language. Grammar, you know, came out from there. The bulk of Arabic grammar right now was based on the Basri school. Sibawai was from Basra, Persia originally, but you know, was living in Basra. Was an individual. His name was Abu Amr bin Ala. Now someone said, you want to learn Quran? Who do you learn from? And they go to Abu Amr bin Ala. Abu Amr bin Ala was, you know, a really great scholar, and he had one student whose name was his name was Susi, and another student's name was Duri. Susi and Duri. Susi had one student by the name of Nasa'i. Heard of him? Heard of the name Nasa'i?
Yes.
Who is Nasa'i? He's a scholar of Hadith.
Yeah.
He's a scholar of Hadith, isn't it? So Nasa'i was a student of Susi. Sufyan Thawri, heard of him?
Yes.
Was a student of Imam Hamza. Everyone, there's scholars in individual fields, but no one stepped on each other's toes. If you're a scholar of Hadith, you do your Hadith. But when you got to do Quran, you don't know it. So you go to the scholar of Quran to learn Quran. You want a Hadith, you go to the scholar of Hadith. You know, we respect you when it comes to fiqh, but when it comes to Quran, dude, you don't know anything. You refer to Abu Amr Basri, okay, please, thank you very much. That's how normally it was. And then all the way in Damascus. How far is Damascus from Sham and Basra? Anyone? Huh?
2,000 miles.
That's pretty far, huh?
Yeah.
All the way in Damascus was an individual whose name was his name was Abdullah bin Amir. Abdullah bin Amr. He was actually, according to one narration, he was born at the time of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but he never got to see him. And he was really, really young when the Prophet passed away, like 3-4 years old perhaps. According to other narrations, he was born a little later on. And he was an authority of the recitation of the Quran, living in Damascus at the time. Someone said, you want to learn Quran, where are you going to go to, you know, they're like, we will go to, you know, recite with Abdullah bin Amr. You know what type of impact Abdullah bin Amr had done on Damascus? It was such that Imam Shatibi says, وَأَمَّا دِمَشْقُ الشَّامِ دَارُ ابْنُ عَامِرٍ فَتِلْكَ بِعَبْدِ اللَّهِ طَابَتْ مُحَلَّلًا فَتِلْكَ بِعَبْدِ اللَّهِ طَابَتْ مُحَلَّلًا. It says Damascus was such a city that because of Abdullah bin Amr, people were relocating from other cities to move there. They're like, where are you moving? We're going to Damascus. Why? Don't you know Abdullah bin Amr is there? He was just a scholar of Quran. He was a great scholar of Quran. People, you know, they were all, you know, Tabat Muhallala. People were just coming in over there. And sometimes his recitations are really, really different. And you know, including the fact that one of the Mus'haf, one of the Qur'an that Uthman radiallahu anhu prepared was sent to that place. Abdullah bin Amr had direct access to that Mus'haf as well. And he learned the Qur'an. Some say he actually learned the Qur'an directly from Uthman bin Affan. Very interesting, huh? So anyways, and this was an individual living in Damascus. So we've covered how many cities so far? We've covered Mecca, Medina, Basra, Kufa, and Sham. These are the five major hubs of the recitation of the Quran. And that was where Islam was actually spreading. Eventually, what happened is, you know, Islam started to spread, years went by, people were learning Quran. Now listen carefully to this, okay? This was one era, okay, of the recitation of the Quran. It died. It slowly started to die down. You know what I'm saying? It started dying down. And then all of a sudden, in Spain, someone shows up. Someone brought the recitation of the Quran to Spain. His name was Tala Manki. And this individual, he brought the recitation to Spain. And in Spain, all of a sudden, these scholars of Quran started to erupt. And there you had individuals like Abu Amr Adani, such a critic of Quranic recitation. And then you had Abu Amr Adani, and then you had, after that, you had Imam Abu al-Qasim bin Firru al-Shatibi. Heard of him, al-Shatibi? Read a very great scholar of Quran showed up, and he was a blind scholar. And these individuals, they came about later on, and they brought in the recitation of the Quran. And it was anywhere in the world, wherever you were in the world, like, you want to learn to read the Quran, where are you going to go? You know what? Go to Spain, because the Quran is over there. And eventually, from there, certain scholars within history, there's always been certain times when it's died down, and then a scholar erupts and they come up. And this is all based on the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, that in every era there's going to be people who are going to revive the religion. It doesn't necessarily mean, in my opinion at least, it doesn't mean one aspect of it, but it means in every aspect of it. You're always going to find one individual who's going to be a scholar of hadith. They're just going to pop up. They're going to show up. And they're going to be the one that are going to revive the whole science. For example, Sheikh Nasruddin Albani, who came out in the world, right? People have criticism towards him, but a scholar of hadith just showed up, yes or no? A scholar of fiqh just shows up in the world. Scholar of Quran just show up. These are the people that are going to carry. Anytime you come across any of these scholars, show them utmost respect. Trust me, because they totally deserve it. Because these are the people that Allah has chosen to do this. And I find now, and I want to finish with this, that you see, the knowledge is at its peak, and then it dies. And then someone shows up, brings it back up, and then it dies. And then it goes back up, and then it dies. It's going to keep on happening this way. But the sign of the Day of Judgment is clear, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this knowledge is going to eventually finish. And unfortunately, I find that time to be really near to us right now. I'm not going to be, those individuals who are predicting when the Day of Judgment is coming or not. You never know. When I was a young child, my grandparents used to be like, oh my God, I wonder what's going to happen when my grandkids get older, all the fitna in the world. And now I wonder, oh my God, I think Qiyamah's going to come when my children get older. You never know. You heard right or wrong, but we're worried about our children. You never know. Your children might have great grandkids and Qiyamah's not there. Or you never even know, it might show up tomorrow. Who knows, right or wrong? But what I'm trying to say is the sign of the Day of Judgment regarding scholars and regarding scholarship, it's always going to be up and down. It's going to go up and down. But the Prophet's hadith is clear that the Day of Judgment is going to come when this knowledge is going to disappear. It's not like you're going to open up the Quran one day and there'll be nothing written in there. That's not what's going to happen. But look at the way the knowledge is spreading right now. Look at the way the knowledge is spreading right now. Do we all have knowledge? We have access. We have more access to knowledge than Abu Hanifa and Shafi'i and Malik and Ahmad bin Hanbal and Nafi' and Ibn Kathir. We have access to a lot more knowledge than them, true or false. But how many of us are actually true scholars? Because when we need to go and seek the knowledge, what's the first thing that we do? We go Google.com or wherever we need to go. And this is the reality of the world right now. One of the greatest signs of the Day of Judgment. That's why what do we as individuals need to do is, take ourselves and, make the effort on our own to go and, cut whatever bad that there is and go out and serve the Quran, serve the Hadith, serve the science of fiqh, serve this different ulum, because there'll be a time when there'll be no one there that you can turn to for any knowledge at all. There'll be no one there at all. You want to learn Quran? The scholars, they're all dead. You want to learn Hadith? All dead. You want to learn Fiqh? All dead. Knowledge is not superficial. Knowledge is deep. Knowledge is not superficial. Knowledge is deep. Scholars are not superficial. Scholars, they know the depth of the knowledge because they know the what, when, why, where, everything behind the science, everything behind that knowledge. What we have right now is superficial knowledge. What we have right now is superficial knowledge. Are we depth? Do we have depth in it? No. That's where the ulama come in. The people have spent years and years and years. And all of us can spend years also. I mean, many of us, 30, if you spend 10 years spending every single day continuing your regular work, but spend that 10 years, you know, going on and on and on within a specific sense, eventually you'll get the depth behind it. That's why they say the first stage of knowledge is what? Pride. I learn knowledge and I think I know everything. And then I mature on it, and then I realize, oh my God, I don't know anything. Yes or no? So, understand that it's never too late. It's never too late. But, you know, I just wanted to give you a little historical perspective regarding the ups and downs of knowledge, specifically about the recitation of the Quran. How? Started off in Mecca, eventually went to Medina, and then moved on to the five different areas in the world. From there, it traveled down into Spain. From there, people in Egypt took it. You see how this goes on and on and on, different places. The scholars of hadith that are currently living in Pakistan and India are so strong. One individual was giving out, he was an Arab scholar, was giving out hadith certificates, hadith ijazah to the students. And I went and picked up one of those ijazahs and I read it, and everything went down to Shah Wali Allah. And where was Shah Wali Allah from? India. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will preserve this knowledge from places we don't even know. We can never ever imagine. Ibn Khaldun says, most of the scholars were non-Arabs. Out of the seven Qurra, or the seven, you know, great reciters of the Quran, only two of them were Arabs. So, for those of you who are Arabs, and for those of you who are non-Arabs, it's all there. It's up to us to take that initiative, you know, educate your children, make them huffaz, make them, you know, recite the hadith at your house. You know, go ahead and take those first steps. What's the first step towards the knowledge? Read the Quran, read the hadith. And a simple question that I asked was, how many of us actually read Quran every single day? Right? Hadith every single day. You know, reading the stories of the companions, reading all of these different things. So ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, gives us the ability to understand what was said. Jazakumullah khair. One of our brothers, his mother passed away. You know, inshallah, when we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he grants her a high, you know, level in paradise, forgives her sins, cleanses her with the way, you know, the best way possible, and you know, forgives her and cleanses her and, you know, grants her, you know, a high place because of all the effort that she's done to raise, you know, such you know, children in the world that have also grown up as well, inshallah. And, you know, pray for her, inshallah, when you do end up getting a chance. And also, one of the brothers in our community had a child. The child's name is Abdul Rahman. So their aqiqah is going to be next week. So again, we pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, lets this child grow up on Iman and Islam, you know, enables this child to follow the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, grow up to be a flag bearer of Islam, you know, grow up to be a scholar, and who's going to be one of those ups, remember I talked about the ups and the downs, within the knowledge, wherever it is, wherever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chooses to place you, you know, take that. So let's also, you know, send our du'as to this family, this child. Also, next Saturday, aqiqah?
Next Saturday, inshallah.
Next Saturday, inshallah, there's going to be an aqiqah, so I'll try my best to be here. So, inshallah. Jazakumullah khair. Food, there's food?
Food downstairs.
There's food downstairs, if anyone wants to, any questions or no? I think we're hungry. You know what, if anyone has any questions, you can come and, you know, ask me. If any sisters have any questions, you can come from this way. If any brothers have any questions, you can come from this way. Brothers, please don't come on this side because the sisters can't show up, and sisters don't come on this side because the brothers won't show up. Jazakallah khair, food is ready. SubhanAllah, your hadith.